Thank you, choir. Welcome to worship at St. Paul's, both if you're here in the building gathered with us or online, either now or in the future. I'm Craig Maltby. I'll be the worship leader today. Today is the third Sunday of the Easter season, and the reading today is the journey to Emmaus. So watch for signs of the journey throughout the service and of seeing God in all things. We'll start with the life and work of the church. I know Kathy has an announcement.
Thank you, Craig, and good morning, everyone. I'm Kathy Sale. My husband Eric and I are the co-coordinators of Congregational Life. You may have noticed in Friday's newsletter that Ted is soon marking his 40th anniversary of ordination into the United Church of Canada. We are going to celebrate that milestone on Saturday, April 27th in the banquet hall, beginning at 4:30. Please consider making a cash donation so that we may purchase food to provide refreshments for this special occasion. Eric and I will be accepting donations after the service today and again next Sunday. Or an envelope marked Ted's Party can be dropped off at the office. Thanks in advance for helping us celebrate Ted's very special 40th anniversary.
Good morning, all. Dan McCoy, I play the piano here. I just wanted to make a special announcement. Next Sunday at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we've got a... What is this? Who are you? What is this? Who are you? What's happening? Who are you?
I am the ghost of St. Paul's organist past.
St. Paul's organist past. You mean like 1860 or something like that, when the building was built?
No, the recent past, of course. I am here to warn you, Herr Kapell, Mr. McCoy. You are in grave danger.
What do you mean? Why? I don't understand. Danger? Over what?
You don't know the curse of St. Paul's organist. If you stay here for too long, you will lose all of your hair. Hair comes out, mister.
Really? Woo! Are you going to show her?
Woo! You must go. You must leave this place. Go while you can. Leave. Leave.
It worked. I think he's gone. Well, now, since I'm here, I have something to tell you. Getting back to next Sunday. Yes, next Sunday is the day before Earth Day. Earth Day is April 22nd every year. That happens to be next Monday. So we're going to be doing, again, the Misagaia or the Earth Mass. We first did it in 2012 on the very day of Earth Day. We did it again in 2018 on Earth Day. 2012, 2018, 6 years apart. And now it's 2024, 6 years after 2018. Seemed like we should be doing it again. So we are. Next Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock, I was also motivated to arrange this performance of the Misagaia because I love the work, but also it's something that the late Reverend Karen Helfman Milson and I put together when we first did it in 2012, putting together making it a multimedia production with many images that are shown throughout and with dance movement. So partially, I was motivated to think of doing this again in memory of Reverend Karen Hilpin Nelson. As you've been seeing, I hope, about the information in the newsletter, if you're interested in helping support the expense of hiring an instrumental ensemble to play the performance as it was intended, then we would appreciate any donations and appreciate those who have donated for it already. But please spread the word. You may have seen it in the past. It's quite a unique and powerful work, and what better way to celebrate Earth Day next Sunday at 3:00. Any ukuleles around still? I think he took them all. See you next Sunday.
We begin this service by acknowledging that we are all on land that has been inhabited by Indigenous people from the beginning. We are grateful for the opportunity to meet here, and we thank all generations of people who have taken care of this land as we strive to do ourselves today. We acknowledge that the Orillia area is the home of the Anishinaabeg peoples, which include the Ojibwe, Odawa, and Potawatomi nations, and is under the Robinson-Huron Treaty, Williams Treaties, and Jay Collins land purchase. As we are all treaty people, it is important to learn about the lands we stand on and the people who live here. We recognize and deeply appreciate their contributions to this place. We also recognize the contributions that First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and other Indigenous peoples have made in shaping and strengthening this community, our province, and our country. As settlers, this recognition to the contributions and historic importance of Indigenous people must be clearly and overtly connected to our collective conscience to make the promise of truth and reconciliation in our communities.
In today's scripture, we will hear the story of the appearance of Jesus to the two travelers on the road to Emmaus. We also are travelers. Our journeys may be different, but we all need the companionship and support of each other on the road. And so we gather together in worship, seeking to transform our lives from the despair of Good Friday to the hope of Easter. We are an Easter people. Come, let us worship together, for God's world is a wonderful world. We gather together as a community who remembers Jesus, believing that his life, his death, and his life beyond death can transform us to bring about the kingdom of heaven. And so we light this Christ candle as a symbol that Jesus is walking with us. And we light the rainbow candle to affirm our belief that all people are worthy of God's love and to encourage us to be agents of this God's wonderful love. Thank you.
Good morning. My name's Harvey Watt. I'll be reading the children's story this morning, and we have some children. In fact, we have a almost newborn baby. And what's the baby's name?
Owen.
Owen.
You can say, he's my brother.
He's my brother.
And what's his name?
Owen.
And how old is he?
3 months.
Three months.
Lovely. Okay, so the name of the book is We Are All Equal. It's written by an Australian lady named P. Crumble. And we are all equal. Your days are like mine. I chew on bamboo and swing on a vine. We are all equal. You've crossed land and sea. The country's your home now. It's for you and me. Yeah, show them the picture. We are all equal. Our kids we adore. Just because we're parents, we aren't worth more. And the picture is of a big brown bear standing 1 foot with four penguins surrounding it. We are all equal. Your house may be small. I am not better with room to stand tall. That's a bear and a tortoise, and now we have a very long
snake.
A snake and
turtle.
Right. And the turtle is laughing, and the snake is laughing too. We are all equal. You can't walk or run. It doesn't take legs to have lots of fun. We are all equal. You're shaped unlike me. I'm small and slender. You're strong and sturdy. And that's two big elephants and a snake, and the elephants look like they're into the trunk, look like they're laughing. We are all equal. Our love will we decide. We can get married. No love is denied. Two elephants and two fawns with their spots still on them. We are all equal. You're kind and carefree. Beauty is deeper than what you can see. The two fawns and an ox drinking water. We are all equal. While you're not as strong, bullying isn't the way to belong. That's an ox with an owl sitting on its antler, horn. We are all equal. If only you knew, tests cannot measure the good you will do. An owl? What does an owl say? Do you know what an owl says?
Who?
No, what does an owl say? Oh, I said who, right, sorry. I was supposed to be funny, sorry. We're all equal. If only you knew, tests cannot measure the good we will do. We are all equal. Let's shout it out loud. We share hopes and dreams, we're equal and proud, and that's all the animals together, and they're all very happy. And one more page. To all the books get dedicated to all those who take steps each day to create a more equal world. Thanks, Craig.
Thank you.
Creator, as we walk our path, be with us on the road. Accompany us and encourage us in all we do. Those on the Emmaus Road were disappointed and confused. Be with all who are disappointed and confused today. Come alongside them with your reassuring presence. Those on the Emmaus Road had suffered frightening times. Be with those we know who are suffering today, those who have broken hearts, those who are ill, those who are fearful because others are ill. We especially pray for Sylvia White, Katrina Hunt, John Jeffries, Henry Rogler. Accompany and encourage them. Those on the Emmaus Road found a companion to share their journey. Open our eyes to those we need to accompany on their road today. Give us courage and the resources to reach out to others that we meet in our daily lives. Those on the Emmaus Road recognize the divine presence that accompanied them, and their hearts were alive. Help us to notice God in all things as we journey, and to fill our hearts with the fire of your presence. And so we as a community pray together the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. You are the hands of God. Your gifts of time and money enable this community to do the work of the kingdom. Thank you.
tonight.
As promised, we continue our journey on the road to Emmaus. Reading today from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." This is our reading for today.
Thank you, John. When I was growing up at St. Paul's, I sang in the choir, and we sat over in the pews over there looking at these stained glass windows, which most of you can't see. And I always thought that it was wonderful that they had put in those stained glass windows just for the benefit of the kids in the choir. Of course, that's not true. In the old days, back in the 50s, there were actually pews over here. But then the church in the late 50s, 60s started to face declining in attendance. And we're looking for a way to be more intimate in the seating arrangements. So they took out the pews and put in a chapel for communion. And so we have the frost windows, the road to Emmaus. And at the end it says, "He was made known to them in the breaking of the bread." So what a wonderful set of windows to have for the communion chapel. I've talked to a lot of people about those memories, and none of us can actually remember taking communion in that chapel. And so as time changes, we find new uses for the building. It's wonderful. But that's not what I want to talk about today. What I want to talk about is the relation of this story, The Road to Emmaus, to the solar eclipse this past week. For some of our Christian family, this eclipse was seen as a portent of the second coming of Jesus. And so they were disappointed not to actually see Christ on Monday. But I wonder if, like the travelers on the road to Emmaus, they missed the divine presence, even though it was right there in front of them. Much like last week's moose in the quilt that Jim couldn't see, most of us miss things right in front of our face. And what we fail to see most often is the divine presence and action in our lives. As I watched the TV feeds from the United States of the eclipse, I was struck by the almost religious language that all the journalists were using to describe the experience. They talked about feeling the vastness of the universe and creation, about feeling the connection to the other people. They were participating in something greater than themselves, about feeling a sense of awe. They were all experiencing the divine, they just weren't naming it the way we might. The Jesuits have a phrase for this: seeing God in all things. But like the travelers on the road to Emmaus, most of us don't. So how can we open our eyes to see God in all things? Practice. When I watch Dan playing songs by ears, I'm tempted to say, oh, he has a gift. Isn't it a wonderful gift? No, it's practice. The daily drudge of playing scales, playing chords, trying to transpose music that you listen to until it's automatic and you can do it as part of your life. Practice. And so it is with religion. So I want to talk about a practice, a spiritual practice that is used by the Jesuits to see God in all things. The founder of the Jesuits, Ignatius Loyola, said, if you don't have time for any other prayer during the day, make sure you do the spiritual reflection called the examine. Notice the spelling of examine. It doesn't spell like it sounds. And I know you're all going to go home and research what I'm saying, and so just make sure you've got the spelling right. The Jesuits use the examine to see the hand of God in their lives, and they motivate the practice by using this story, the story of the road to Emmaus. The first lesson we learn from this story is that rarely do we notice God at the time. Instead, it is after the fact. The travelers did not recognize Jesus, but after the fact, they knew who it was when they looked back on the journey. So the Jesuit practice at the end of the day is to review the day's events, looking for the blessings and presence of God. Notice we don't search for our failings or try to remember all the bad things. That's easy. Everybody does that automatically. The hard thing is to see God. So that's what we practice. The second lesson that the Jesuits draw from the Emmaus story is how we notice God in our lives. Didn't our hearts burn within us? Noticing God in our lives is about feelings. The Jesuits talk about the inner movements of our lives. Most of the time, these inner movements are very subtle, so we don't notice them. We have to slow down, be quiet, practice to notice them. Rarely, like during the eclipse, they burst out and overwhelm us. But the practice of the examine is to notice the subtle movements, the small feelings, the still small voice of God. Here are some, if you're doing the examine, here are some questions for reflection. And I've taken them from Margaret Silf's book, The Inner Compass, which describes this practice. As you look back on the day, how were you drawn to God today? By a friend? The beauty of nature? A book? A letter? A gentle thought? Review those. Look for the feelings that accompanied them. Did you meet God in fears, in joys, work, misunderstandings? One way of meeting God is to recognize our need for God. Did you bring Christ to those around you? Did someone bring Christ to you? Think of the times that you helped someone or that someone helped you. Have you been a sign of God's presence and love on the road that we all walk? Did you come across someone who was lonely, sad, discouraged, or in need? And did you recognize that need? That is the voice of God. Did you sense the presence of God in the wider world, perhaps in what you saw on TV or read in the paper? Did you notice your feelings at that time? Did anything happen today to make you feel loved? Were you able to show love to another person today? Did you see God in creation? And again, you may not have thought about it being God in creation at the time. You may have just said, look at the beautiful sun, look at the butterflies. It's after the fact that we see the hand of God in that. We are practicing our ability to discern the small everyday signs of God. Otherwise, even if Jesus magically appeared on the road we're walking or at a solar eclipse, we're likely to not notice. By the daily practice of praying the examine, we can improve our ability to see God in all things and thus to realize it's a wonderful world. Amen. Go now as witnesses of God in all things. The risen Christ has made himself known to you as you journey towards the kingdom. So set your faith and hope on God. And may you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet. And may everyone see the face of Christ in you. Amen.